Hi guys, story recaps here. Today, I am going to explain a 2016 Australian science fiction film called The OSIRIS Child. Spoilers ahead, watch out and take care. It's a long time in the future, and mankind has begun to conquer the universe. Exor, an off-Earth military contracting firm situated in a massive skyscraper, looks down on a horrible world that is home to a prison camp in OSIRIS' capital city. A military facility, the flotilla, is next to the complex. Lieutenant Kane Somerville, a troubled war hero, who fled Earth after an accident on an early combat mission he led, that resulted in the deaths of virtually all of his crew, is in charge of assisting future settlements. Higher-ups accused him of substance misuse, and while he was exonerated due to his distinguished career as a jet pilot, he and his family were never the same. Living on the flotilla makes it difficult for him to visit Indy Somerville, his 11-year-old daughter. Her out on a ride through the planet's desert, although she is such a desolate wasteland, does not impress me. Indy informs him that her mother believes he is fleeing, but he deflects the remark by stating that he hasn't spoken to her in a long time and that he is glad to be a part of a project that is laying the groundwork for humanity's new future. Before they go to check out the new bunkers together, he loans her his weapon and trains her how to shoot to be on his daughter's good side. Indy is transferred to OSIRIS City to remain with a babysitter when they're finished, as she isn't allowed up in the flotilla with him. Morning comes for Kane and the flotilla after a glimpse of the beasts who lie in the wasteland during the night. Travis, his AI, wakes him up and makes his breakfast while listening to his communications. While glancing at several reports, Kane dismisses the ones from a coworker and his wife, but he does listen to Indy's. However, the transmission is abruptly cut short, and when Kane asks Travis to restore it, the AI tells him that he can't since all communications to the surface have been momentarily blocked due to jail disturbances. General Linux, who is in charge of the Exor complex, is the type of person who is more concerned with her own place in the cosmos than with the people who really live in it. She is currently receiving a status report on the colony following the breach of the jail, where some creatures made by Exor have gotten inside and are killing captives. The outer cities have likewise vanished, and the monsters are only a matter of time before they murder everyone on the surface. The Colonel wants to save as many lives as possible, but Linux fears that doing so will damage the company's reputation, so she convenes a conference to promote an alternative idea. She tells the audience, including Kane, that the inmates have rioted and are in possession of a dangerous virus that Exor experimented on, which they are now exploiting to hold the world hostage. Exor will release the disease in the capital if they try to interfere or save people. This necessitates Protocol 84, which calls for the colony's complete annihilation. However, Linux claims that if the inmates learn of it, they will be able to negotiate a better bargain. They have 23 hours to complete it, and Linux assures everyone that the citizens of the capital and the families of her employees will be okay. Every participant should be given a tag, and the colonel should keep a watch on them for the next 23 hours. If there is any strange movement, they should be segregated. Kane attempts desperately to reach Indy after receiving the news, but to no effect, and when he asks Travis for reports on the prison event, he is told they are classified. The colonel takes pity on him and, for the sake of their friendship, tells Kane the truth. There is no virus. Instead, Exor has been secretly working on the production of ragged animals that would be exported and employed in the establishment of new colonies for years. The monsters have escaped the hostage crisis and are on their way to the main metropolis. Exor will detonate the reactors in 23 hours. Kane is enraged at the colonel for lying to him and allowing his family to accompany him when he knew what was going on beneath the surface, but the colonel is too busy to dispute. He informs Kane that the hangar bay will be locked down in 20 minutes, after which no one will be allowed to enter or exit the station. Kane chooses to do what he does best, fly. He steals a ship and flees the station, flying with incredible skill to avoid the officers who are chasing him. When this ship is forced to exceed G-force in order to destroy the final Exor guard, he loses consciousness and the emergency system takes over, ejecting him from his seat. Kane manages to pull off his seat belt and activate his parachute at the last second, allowing him to safely land in the lake. That is, until he stands up and a mysterious man with a weapon knocks him out. When Kane awakens on the ground, he discovers that the person who pulled him there is Cy Lombrook, who is now aiming a revolver at him. He tries to explain the issue by stating a story about the criminals having access to the reactors, but Cy was a nurse at the jail, so he knows he isn't speaking the truth. To persuade him of his claim about the planet exploding soon, Kane tells him that he wants to save his daughter, who is now staying at the capital, and that if Psi helps him rescue her, he will grant him access to a safety bunker, which Psi accepts. Psi can later be seen as a prisoner in the planet's jail in a flashback. Vim and Crete are contemplating a plot to escape using information supplied to Psi by another prisoner named Carmel. Crete believes it is a suicide mission, but Psi believes it is now or never, so Crete and Vim agree until they learn that a convict named Bostock and his group have also been admitted. To complete the next part of the plan, they must all be held in solitary confinement in order to locate the proper exit. Carmel tries to be sent to isolation, but is instead hauled into a meeting with Warden Mordane, who mocks him for being religious and tells him he won't send him to solitary any longer before assaulting him, while two policemen restrain him. Meanwhile, Psi begins a battle in the mess hall. Mordane and the guards enter the mess hall, interrupting the battle, which they, to everyone's astonishment, let to continue as long as the crowd behaves. Because this is part of the plot, Crete acts out and injures the man who is beating Psi, triggering a disturbance and requiring the guards to intervene to stop them. The inmates are placed in solitary confinement, which consists of rotating cells with flashing lights that can cause mental anguish in the inmates. Psi is also staying there until Mordane arrives to whisk him and Vim away for a very special mission. In the present, Psi warns Kane that they won't be able to make it to the capital in time. They won't be able to get across the mountains on foot, but there is a contraband outpost beyond the mountains where they can locate a vehicle. When ships pass by and the soldiers kneel to hide in the tall grass, it's clear that Exor is already on the lookout for Kane. They arrive at the outpost bar, where Jip and Bill are having a good time throwing knives at a human-shaped target. The bartender informs Kane that the couple outside owns the bus, so he attempts to speak with them, but they become enraged since he has disrupted their game. When Bill calls him out, Psi steps in and tells them that Kane is an Exor deflector who simply wants to see his family and is prepared to pay them $20,000 for the trip. Bill is willing to accept Kane as long as he passes Jip's test, which entails getting high and throwing a knife at a target. Kane passes the test because his aim is excellent, and the four of them decided to leave and take a detour to acquire some guns. In jail, another flashback begins. Vim awakens inside a cage to find a monster approaching him, which uses its tongue to slash his neck and inject him with a lethal substance. Mordane is also close, as he wakes up within a cage. He continues to explain Exor's terraforming project to him, including how they are generating these monsters by altering captives and making them into beings capable of development and adaption regardless of their surroundings. Psi vanishes when the floor collapses beneath him, and he reappears in another chamber, where Bostock awaits him, having successfully carried out the plan. He's gotten clothes and bogus IDs, including one that claims Psi is a nurse, but Crete interrupts their plans, claiming he's let the devil loose. The animals start killing everyone in the building, including the monster that was once Vim and is now killing Mordane. Bostock and Crete want to travel to the capital, but Psi says he can't because he wants to attend to the opera, so they split up. Another leap in time has occurred, and Earth may now be seen 2 years ago. Psi has been told that he will be sentenced to 20 years in prison, possibly 15, and that he will be depicted as a monster for breaking the code and betraying the public's trust. Psi believes that nothing counts any longer. Kane and Psi are waiting for the guns they ordered in the presented by two men, Mandel and Joe, who ask for $30,000 as payment. Kane gives them the money they desire and the group disperses. As soon as they're out of sight, the men rejoice over their newfound wealth. They notice something strange in the distance after drinking and dancing. It's the monsters approaching them. Joe and Mandel try to protect themselves by firing them out the windows, but while they kill a few, the remainder of the beasts manage to get into their shack. Joe has no choice except to indicate a grenade. Kane is informing everyone else on the bus about the creatures and the bomb that will go off 4 hours later in the evening. They talk about how they got there, their fate and the consequences, as well as the ethics of exploiting inmates for free work. When they arrive in OSIRIS a few hours later, the city is in shambles, with monsters invading from every direction and infecting more humans in order to modify them. The party draws their weapons and agrees that Jip and Bill would provide cover and protect the bus, while Kane sets out to retrieve his daughter with Psi. As Kane and Psi enter the building Indy resides in, the couple shoots any monsters that get close. They run across one of their neighbors, who claims he hasn't seen Indy before allowing them to proceed upstairs. Indy is secure, since she has been hiding in the closet since the nanny died. The three of them try to climb the stairs after telling Indy her nanny has gone home to shelter her from reality, but they're blocked by a monster, so they'll have to find another way out. Meanwhile, Jip has dragged Bill back into the bus after a creature has injured him. She looks for a first aid kit but can't find one, so she has to watch Bill die in her arms. Kane, Sai, and Indy reach the building's roof and close the door behind them. Sai grabs Indy and jumps off the roof, landing safely on top of the bus, because there is no other way out. After that, Kane follows them but nearly falls. Fortunately, Sai holds him and helps him climb onto the bus with them. They begin pounding on the hatch, pleading with Jip to open it and let them in, but Jip is hesitant due to what happened to Bill. She eventually gives in and unlocks the hatch for them before boarding the bus and driving them away while Sai covers Jip's body with a blanket. Kane explains what's going on to his daughter and apologizes for not being more involved in her life. Indy accepts his apology and forgives him. He also shows Jip how to go to the bunker and ensures that everyone knows the code to get inside. Linux is in the process of beginning Protocol 84 in the Exor complex, when she receives word that a bus is nearing one of their bunkers, so she dispatches a spacecraft to pursue them. Indy notices it through the glass, so Kane orders her to flee before asking Jip not to take the turn so the ship doesn't figure out where they're headed. The spacecraft exits after trailing them for a short time, and Jip takes the turn towards the bunker. They're halfway there when the ship appears in front of them and begins shooting, only to leave when it runs out of ammunition. Jip and Kane have been killed. Sai and Indy, on the other hand, are okay. Indy doesn't want to leave her father, but since they don't have much time, Sai snatches her up and drives her off the bus to the bunker. On the way, a monster spots them and pursues them into the caves, infecting Sai with its tongue as he shoots it down. They locate the bunker door and Indy enters the code, allowing her and Sai to enter just before the planet is blasted. Sai, on the other hand, is starting to turn into a monster, so he asks Indy to fetch him something sharp with which he may murder himself. She can't do it alone, so she speaks to him and touches him while his body changes. Sai's life as a nurse in an Earth hospital is shown in another flashback. When the patients they bring in are his wife and daughter and neither of them survives, he makes use of his position as a nurse and enters the room of the man who caused the accident that murdered his family, punching him and attempting to choke him until security intervenes. Many days have passed since the explosion, in the present. Two explorers discover the bunker and notice Indy, who is dressed in a spacesuit, in the distance. After killing one explorer, they utilize the opportunity to interrogate the other about what's going on out there, and they've become a monster but have preserved some sanity owing to Indy. The explorer reveals that the flotilla was recalled after the tragedy, and that the tale they're telling everyone is that convicts revolted and took control of the reactors, resulting in a meltdown with no survivors. Indy tells her that if she wants to live, she has no choice but to accept her offer, to take her inside of the flotilla undetected. Sai communicates with him using sign language, before Indy rubs his head and holds his hand, telling him they're finally going home and saying goodbye to her father. Subscribe and turn on the notifications. We daily upload videos like this.